Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of 2016. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as they interfere with the broadcasting system. Members will refer to tablets during the course of the meeting because we provide papers in a digital format. Apologies have been received this morning from Cara Hilton. Agenda item one is to decide whether to consider item three in private. Are we agreed, members? Thank you very much. Agenda item two is our substantive look at our legacy paper. We'll take evidence from two panels today. The first will consist of academics, followed by former local authority chief executives. Over the course of session four, in terms of legislation, the committee has dealt with or is dealing with the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill, the Community Empowerment Scotland Bill, the Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Bill, the Disabled Persons Parking Places Scotland Bill, the Buildings Recovery of Expenses Scotland Bill, High Hedges Scotland Bill, and the Local Government Finance Unoccupied Properties, etc. Scotland Bill. And inquiries that we've undertaken include ones into arm's length external organisations, fixed odds betting terminals, inquiry into the flexibility and autonomy of local government, delivery of regeneration in Scotland, public service reform, which was a three-strand inquiry, Scottish local government elections 2012, and the inquiry into a living wage in Scotland. Can I welcome the first panel today, Professor Ken Gibb, Professor in Housing Economics, Professor Annette Hastings, Professor of Urban Studies, Professor Aid Kearns, Professor of Urban Studies, and Dr. James White, Lecturer in Urban Studies. Can I start by asking the panel, how would you characterise the committee's legacy? Who would like to start, please? Nobody willing to bite the bullet? Shall I pick somebody? Ladies first, Professor Hastings.
That's very unfair. Unexpected question, I have to say. We haven't actually seen sort of a legacy paper. I think we submitted some evidence on particular aspects of the committee's work that we were particularly interested in.
Can I maybe clarify? You're here to help us formulate our legacy paper.
Okay.
And that should have been conveyed to you, which I understand it was.
Right. Well, I think, yes, in broad terms, that's what we think we're here to do. I guess I would comment on some of the work that I've previously provided evidence to you on. My actual submission is about the cuts to local government funding, and I'm happy to talk about that in some detail. Community Empowerment Act Bill, I was involved in your scrutiny of that, and I have to say that as a committee, I was very impressed that you took on board quite a lot of the submissions that were made by a range of stakeholders, particularly around how the Community Empowerment Act, our bill, as originally drafted, had the potential to amplify disadvantage. And I think it was very pleasing that those ideas were taken on board in the actual bill. I think in terms of going forward, there's obviously concerns about how the provision to support disadvantaged groups in the community empowerment agenda can actually be implemented, given the severity of austerity and cuts to local government budgets in particular. And I think that would be something in terms of forward-looking issues that would be important. So that would be one remark, I think, about the work that I'm aware of that the committee has been doing.
Okay, does anyone else want to come in at this point? Professor Gibb, please.
Yeah, I guess I would point to, you mentioned the local government flexibility autonomy type issues. I would point to the major work that's been underway in the local tax commission and the work that's been done there. And clearly, in a sense, the interesting part now is to come in terms of what the different political parties and the government wish to do with the options that they've been presented to them. At the same time, We have the other issue the Local Tax Commission dealt with or considered, the freeze, and we're going to have a ninth year of the freeze, and that clearly raises a lot of issues about flexibility and autonomy of local government. So looking forward, as it were, I would imagine that that's going to be an important and significant part of your agenda.
The foundation of the Commission was obviously a recommendation from this committee.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you think that the formation of the Commission would have taken place if it hadn't been for the inquiry that we carried out into the flexibility of local government?
I think it clearly helps greatly. I think the nature of the committee in particular, the fact that unlike the Burt inquiry before it, it was an attempt to have an all-party approach, including a wider range of independents as well, made it, you know, gave it a stronger kind of heft from the very outset. So I think that has obviously been very important, and as I say, is a significant improvement on the Burt inquiry in terms of its credibility, even though I would personally, make the point that I think the Burt inquiry is a very good piece of work.
Thank you. Professor Kearns, please.
Yeah, so I looked at two areas that you, as a committee, had looked at in your last session. One was community empowerment, and the other was the delivery of regeneration. And I think in both of those areas, there's still a lot of work to be done. So your forward-looking agenda is extremely important, I think, despite the fact that you delivered quite hefty reports on both those things in the past. In my submission about community empowerment, looking forward, I'm aware that there's currently a review of the standards, national standards for community engagement going on at the moment for the Scottish Government. And I think there's quite a lot to be done there, because those standards have been in operation for quite some time, and a lot of public bodies and third sector bodies would profess to adhere to those standards. Yet we've been studying the effects of community engagement and empowerment processes in deprived communities, and it is possible to find that adherence to the standards doesn't guarantee empowerment for the community. So that's a bit of an issue, I think. And I don't think there is currently very good evidence about what the effects of those standards are upon empowerment, if empowerment is to be the outcome of the standards. In other words, the standards describe a process, but they don't guarantee an outcome. And I think that's a bit problematic, because it is too easy for public authorities and other agencies to consider the job done if they have complied with the standards. It seems to me the standards are a means to an end, in my view, not an end in themselves. So that is why in my submission I said one of the issues I would select for further scrutiny is what are the effects of the engagement standards.
We have endeavoured to go around the country and speak to as many people as possible, and to have as many folks, ordinary folks as possible, come and give us evidence, often in informal settings. I think it would be fair to say that the levels of engagement are so different in various parts of the country. We have seen during the course of our travels some immense engagement. Dundee is probably the best example that we've come across, I would say, and I'm looking at colleagues, where budgets have actually followed as well as just the engagement. So it's not just lip service, it's an influencing on budgeting. One of the things that we've seen of late is a move to participatory budgeting, I think maybe with some influence from the committee. Do you think that that will help in terms of improving engagement, where people themselves will have a say in how certain monies are spent?
It's clearly important that people have a say in how money is spent. I think one of the issues we find in engagement processes is people need to understand the parameters of the process. In other words, people need to be clear what is up for grabs and discussion and what is not up for grabs and discussion. So something like what is the financial envelope within which something is going to be delivered is quite important for people to know. But I think one of the issues for communities is that the the infrastructure of organisations that make decisions is getting more and more complicated, and that whole process, the arena in which you are involved and local authorities are involved, other public agencies, is getting very complicated. And if that's not explained very well, people are often go through a process of engagement and are still unclear who is making decisions, and secondly, who is responsible for delivery, either of regeneration, which is what we've looked at, or in the case of services, who is responsible for delivery in accord with decisions that they think have been made. That is often not clear to people. And I suppose I was trying to argue to you that that side of the process is the potentially empowering one, but also the potentially disempowering one. It's one thing to take part in participatory budgeting or other discussions with service providers, but then to know nothing about what happens next seems to me to be a lacuna that needs to be filled.
Jane Baxter, please.
Thanks, Convener. Just on that point, and I have to say I agree with very, very much of what Professor Kearns has said, but I think how we take that forward, because knowledge is power and information is at the root of that, and things do have to be explained and communities have to be supported to take on board that information and work out what they're going to do about it. But that needs support at local level. So does anybody in the panel have a view about how reductions in council budgets and the need to make savings, how is that going to impact on the capacity of local staff and local communities to participate as well and as effectively as we'd all like them to? That's constrained by capacity, I think.
If you take the example of what we've been studying, a multi-million pound delivery of regeneration effort in the city of Glasgow, it would take a very, very, very minute proportion of that expenditure to finance support to communities to understand the processes of change and decision-making. When council housing, for example, and Scottish Homes housing was transferred to community ownership 20 years ago, in every case the community received a right to independent consultancy, to support them in that process. That's not happening at the moment. One of the points I was trying to make to you is communities should have a right to independent support, because what's very difficult is if public bodies set up a process to engage and collect community views about something, and I agree with you about information, but if the only information that the community get comes from the person or the body with a stake in the outcome of that process, then there is a great scope for bias in the provision of information, whether it's the kind of information or the lack of information that is given. And the only way to ensure empowerment is that communities have some independent view as to what information they're receiving, what is possible in the process in which they are engaged, what are the potential outcomes beyond the ones on offer to them or in front of them. And they don't know those things without a third voice that's neither them nor the delivery organisation giving them that advice. That would be my point. And that wouldn't cost very much money.
Dr. White, if you want to answer my question and what characterises the committee's legacy and Ms. Baxter's at the same time, I'd be grateful.
Well, I should say first that my work is primarily on Canadian cities. So and that's what I sort of wrote my submission here on, and in particular on engagement with local people on Toronto's waterfront, which is a project perhaps similar in scope and size to efforts on Dundee's waterfront and also in Glasgow and other large cities with lots of vacant land coming forward for master planning. So I guess from a legacy perspective and the future work of the committee, I would say that taking some time to look at examples of best practices where communities have been involved in processes of large-scale regeneration in other countries and other places would probably bring value to understanding some of the challenges, some of the wicked problems that are faced here. And the work on Toronto sort of speaks to this idea of making sure that people are involved very much from the start of a regeneration process and therefore have information with them right at the beginning of the process and then can be involved in different ways throughout development. So this is specifically in relation to sort of development in the built environment. I think there's an opportunity with the Charette mainstreaming program that the Scottish Government are working on to take forward some of these ideas of long-term involvement in development issues in cities. My sense is that some of the Charettes, while working well as individual events, sometimes privilege professional expertise just because of the types of people that show up. So ensuring that we have a sort of a way to get more local people, more communities involved in these processes, so it's not just a talking shop of experts on different silos of the development process, I think would be helpful.
Thank you. Professor Hastings, please.
Can I just address myself to your question, Jane Baxter? From the perspective of cuts to local government budgets, of course, we know that the English case in England, the cuts have been quicker and more severe, and there is evidence emerging from England in relation to your question. It would suggest that community organisations are finding it difficult to maintain their energy as capacity building activities diminish, and in some places they've been the first things to be cut. One of the ways in which many English local councils are managing austerity is by passing more responsibility onto local people, not just to participate in budgeting activity and participation type mechanisms, but to deliver services, to run facilities. Given what we're about to face in Scotland and the severity of the cuts to come, Scottish councils need to be aware of the dangers of doing that without also investing the relatively small amounts of resource in developing the capacity of disadvantaged communities in particular to take on those new responsibilities. Otherwise, big gaps in services are bound to open up.
Professor Gibb, please.
Yeah, I'd like to make two quick points to the questions that have just been raised. First of all, about participative budgeting, I think the evidence that people at Oliver Escobar have drawn from around the world suggests that when it's not a gimmick, but when it's a long-term embedded set of policies which have a kind of educational evolutionary element in it, so that the people who are making decisions are actually involved on a continuous basis and set up their own participative structures to do that. And there's evidence in South America of that, there's evidence in France of that. That's particularly, you know, a potentially very, very valuable thing to do. And I know that many local authorities in Scotland are undertaking training that the government is supporting them with just now in order to make PB a reality. On the issue of austerity and capacity, I've been working in What Works Scotland looking at community planning partnerships for the last 18 months or so, and it's clear that a number of local authorities on the ground, that the staff who run the CPPs are under a lot of pressure with, and the way that the budgets manifest themselves, budget cuts manifest themselves, is that they there's a continuous process of organisational change underway, considerable uncertainty on the part of key staff as to what they're going to be delivering, and that simply isn't an environment where the kinds of sort of system change that everybody wants to see can actually occur.
John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. While I would be tempted to go into debate with Professor Kearns about the resources that were made available during 20 years ago during the stock transfer debate, I'll resist that because I think there's clearly a difference of opinion in terms of what support was provided to
community. Whether or not it was independent.
Or whether or not it was truly independent from the process. But part of today's session is to look at the legacy and the work of the past almost five years of this committee. And the question I'd like to ask the panel today, convener, is there's been mention of the community empowerment, there's been mention of the regeneration. What could this committee have done better to address some of the concerns? And you've made reference to the potential cuts in local government budgets, the stresses that are going to be faced, both at local government level delivery of services, but also in terms of community empowerment. What do you think this committee could have done in relation to the inquiries that were held, the discussions that we had with various academics, professionals, communities, that would have helped in developing better strategies to put forward as a committee?
Who's going to take that on first, then?
I'll say Kearns. One thing that occurs to me. In the research that we've done, I think one of the issues for me is how individuals and their families are supported in any of these processes. I mean, there is a slight conundrum between the reformulation of the arrangements for services which tend to look for efficiencies in times, obviously, of reduced budgets. And one way of trying to achieve efficiencies of all sorts of kinds is to scale up the point at which you plan things and to try to get different services to cooperate in better ways than they had before. I think the dilemma is that in doing that, which is not something I would argue against doing, but to realise that in scaling up things so that large bodies can talk to one another, you lose the opportunity for people lower down in the system to have input to that system. So I would say looking at the effect of the rearrangements upon the ability either of the communities that we study to engage in that process or to find an entry point into that process, I think is one of the things I would look for. And the second is to look at the effects of austerity and other changes in the economy upon individual households. What we find is there are lots of things planned for either spatial areas or communities and far less planned for supporting individuals who face challenges and difficulties. So the individual perspective, I think, is often lost, I would say.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in on that point?
I could make a point about the context in which the committee is working rather than the committee itself, that I think a change in the policy context might be helpful for this committee's work. And it's in relation to the 2010 Equalities Act and the idea of the commencement of the socio-economic duty on public bodies, which I understand the independent advisor on poverty and equality is recommending this morning to the First Minister and is also supported by SURF and by the Poverty Alliance. And I think that embedding the idea that public agencies must build into their policy and implementation process an anti-discrimination policy with regard to disadvantage, I think is a clear is central to making the public sector work better for regeneration areas in a more mainstream routine way than perhaps is currently done. So there was certainly in the early days of the committee there was quite a lot of discussion about the effect of means to deliver regeneration and debate about the role that mainstream agencies, public sector agencies, could play in that. I'm not sure that debate has gone much further than the proposals in the Christie Commission and elsewhere around the reform of public agencies. I think there's more room to do. There's more space to do more with the public sector and to repurpose it in a way which makes it more routine for it to be considering socioeconomic disadvantage as part of its daily activities.
Okay, John.
Just as a follow-up, while I take on board the issue about how we analyse what's happening and how we can then try and predict and some of the austerity measures that are now coming through, it could be argued that they could have been predicted 5 years ago because of the direction of travel the Westminster government are going. But the issue about how we deal with individual households and how we get the experience of the individual household, because like many organisations, this committee can only speak to certain groupings around the country, and we rely on those groupings to try and relay some of the experiences of communities and individual households. How do we get that better? I know that in terms of some of the paperwork that's been provided today, you've given examples of where there is work taking place in communities and with individuals within those communities. Because many years ago when I worked in community development, we used to talk about the finger deletes were the only ones that actually got in through the door and it was only ones that you heard from. How do we get, as a committee and as a parliament, to those individuals and get the experiences of those individuals in relation to the developing our policies and strategies and reports for government?
Who wants to have a crack at that? Professor Kearns?
I would see whether there's a way of engaging civil society organisations to provide you with evidence and experience. I understand what you're saying about there's only so many people you can talk to.
Professor Kearns, I accept civil society. Yeah. There is a wider debate about whether or not civil society and the community planning partnerships truly represent the communities they attend the community planning partnerships. And it's, what I'm trying to get here is, how do we get the experience of the individual households where many of these policies that are being pursued by Westminster and the Scottish Government How do we get their experience? How do we get the knowledge of what the impact of those policies are on those individual households?
Well, there are services that deal with those individuals. GP practices are one of those. If it were me, I would try to access the organisations that deal with some of those to get some of those people to come and speak to you. I mean, it is possible to get evidence about individual cases that can help. We also try to speak directly to some of the people involved in order to do that. I think there should be ways that you can try to do that. I accept that you can't directly yourselves as 10 individuals or whatever do that, but you can set up arrangements to do that, I would think.
Dr. White, do the Canadians do anything different in terms of trying to engage with households and individuals?
I don't think anything massively different. I think that the Canadian, in Toronto at least, they're very effective at getting people involved and learning about people's experiences when there's something happening that directly affects them, in the case of a large, in planning, in the case of large development projects. So when there's something physical happening in the environment close by that people are passionate about or want to feel that they've got a role to play in shaping, then they tend to be more interested in getting involved. I'm not an expert on the wider involvement of people in Canadian society.
Professor Gibb.
I'm just going to say that I'm aware of two local authorities in the west of Scotland who are currently trying to drive their community planning processes down to neighbourhood levels. Glasgow, with its thriving places, and West Dumbartonshire, with its communities. And they both face the same kind of issue, that it's like a fractal. The problem of difficult-to-reach groups operates at every level, and they're all trying to think, what's the best way to get access to people and the neighbourhood levels who aren't the usual suspects, who aren't the activists who will always get involved, to find ways which are genuinely representative of what's going on at a street level or whatever. And I think they're all doing lots of different things, lots of things, which is exactly what, you know, would come out of the community development literature, I guess. Lots of events, lots of ways of trying to communicate directly with people, drawing in the services that Aid was talking about. But they all face, it's a universal problem, it seems to me, that we're all trying to wrestle with, and in a context where we are talking about less resources being available for these sorts of things, it's clearly that's just another layer of a big challenge that's being faced. But people are working very hard just now, seems to me, trying to crack that nut.
So what's the barriers to bringing these processes down to a neighbourhood level?
Well, the barriers are, I guess, that you have a local authority which has a community planning level of analysis at a local authority wide level, and you're trying to, in a sense, replicate and get to grips with really local issues. So you're having to produce similar processes, similar modes of accountability, similar service discussions at a local scale, and you have to think through what the most effective way to do that is. So in West Dumbartonshire's case, they've been piloting a series of these low-level planning arrangements in one area, but they're now trying to roll it out into others, and they're trying to learn lessons. And I guess the fact is that every local authority will have its own dynamics and its own issues to contend with. So there isn't, as it were, you know, if it works in Glasgow, it'll undoubtedly work in East Lothian or vice versa. So there's inevitably real-time work that has to be done to learn lessons and try and make the
process. But there's nothing new in all of this.
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
I think one of the differences here is that it depends what the purpose of trying to find out is about. I agree with what you said earlier about how do you get the voice of ordinary people who are affected by these things, and how do you as a committee get that, or how does a local authority do that? Now, it seems to me there's a difference between saying we want some people involved from communities in decision-making processes around community planning, and there are, as you know, complicated arrangements to do that, and they will engage with a certain type of person. I think trying to find out about real experiences and evidence of impacts would require speaking of a different type of person, possibly. Now, local authorities do large-scale things, like they survey their populations to find out what people think about them as a local authority and the services they provide. And they would call that some sort of citizens' panel. Glasgow has one, many other local authorities have one. So that's a panel to conduct a survey with. Now, I think there's a different type of panel that local authorities and yourselves could have, which is a panel about experiences. That's not engaging people to make decisions. It's engaging people to tell you about their lives. And that's a different type of panel to a panel of 1,000 people. We're not talking about a large-scale panel. But it seems to me a different type of arrangement to get the experiential evidence that you say is difficult to grasp would be a way forward. And that's what we try to do in what we do, have a panel of people who can tell us about their lives in their own time and in their own way, without having a battery of questions that we want to ask them to start with. It's a different type of citizens' panel, if you like.
John? Dr. Wright?
I'll just add one extra point. I haven't researched this work directly, but I could look into it more if the committee was interested. But in some North American cities, a colleague of mine at the University of British Columbia, where I used to be a PhD student, did work on something called mini-publics. And what this essentially involved was almost like calls for jury service being sent out to a community group to invite them to come along, often with a small referendum for a two-day work. A smaller honorarium to come along to a workshop that would take a day of their time. So they would be invited by government to come and talk about bigger policy ideas. So because often you can get community groups involved in local issues, as Ken said, harder perhaps to engage with the general public on bigger policy statements, bigger issues. And so they would send out letters to a large group of people and then have a smaller group from that, then a cross-section of people come and be involved in understanding a policy and where it came from and commenting on it.
Thank you. John?
No further questions. No.
Small point, and just to say that we don't have to do additional work on this issue, I think, in order to get at the experiences. And I guess I'll just amplify Ed Cairn's point about the need to make better use of the very good social research evidence that's out there, which does spend a great deal of time with the people that you're concerned about, and talks not just about, you know, their views on a particular policy, but how that really intersects with a whole range of aspects of their lives. And I would suggest that that's something that the committee could look at in the future.
Jane?
This is maybe a question for the next panel, but I'm going to float it here anyway to see what witnesses think. We've talked a little bit about experiential evidence, and it seems to me that people like councillors and MSPs actually possess quite a lot of that because they do casework. They're talking to constituents all the time and hearing about local issues and local problems. And I'm wondering if there's a view that maybe some of that experience could be built into the system, because at the moment it sort of exists at the side of the system. It's not used to influence practice or policy, but is there a way that it could be?
Yes. The only slight reservation I'd have about that is just about there is also still the people who don't come forward, of course. That's always a bit of a problem that would need supplementing. To that, but I agree with you that there's probably a lot of information in the system, as you call it, that is experiential that's currently not recorded.
Yeah. Professor Gibb?
I wouldn't disagree.
I'd like to make a kind of related point, which I'm just thinking about as you were asking that question, which is, I don't understand the extent to which the different committees interact with each other on specific issues and topics. So, you know, under welfare reform, council tax benefit reduction is not part of universal credit, but it's clearly of direct relevance to low income and poverty and benefits. So there's an interest in, I would have thought, your committee and in welfare reform committee being interested in that. Under the infrastructure and investment group, there's the city deals work, which seems to me to be both committees would be very interested in. And I could imagine there are lots of local labour market and economic issues that finance would be concerned in. So is there a way in which you can pool your knowledge and expertise that actually allows you to build on some of the things that you're, the experiential things you're talking about?
There are interactions, and of course I serve in the Welfare Reform Committee, and we've both committees have looked at certain aspects of these things. And in terms of city deals, as part of our budget inquiry, we have looked into city deals. Is the interactions 100% there? Is it absolutely spot on right? The answer to that is probably not, but that's a personal opinion, maybe some of my colleagues have other views, but I think that certainly that's something that needs to be improved on. Also, you know, in terms of a number of the reports and legislation, it's looked at by more than one committee, as you'll be aware. And currently the burial and cremations bill that we're dealing with, we're not the lead committee, the health committee is. So there is that interaction, but maybe not quite enough. Jane?
An example of that where I would ask a similar question, which is in relation to the place standard. I'm not sure what the committee's involvement was in the place standard, but it's pitched as a sort of a joint effort, if you like, between public health and architecture. But in our work, a very important issue is the quality of neighbourhoods matters a lot to people's quality of life. And one of the issues I raise in my submission, asking the committee, is who is looking at how well that is working? Because that has a potential to either work very well or to exacerbate inequalities between communities, depending who makes best use of the place standard.
Jane, do you want to come back?
No, I'm content, Commissioner. I was just floating an idea.
Grant. Cameron, please.
I noticed, Professor Cairns, you mentioned individuals, getting individuals engaged and a panel of experienced people. This has proved very difficult for us because we tend to see the usual suspects. I wonder how you would comment on that, how to get these individuals actually engaged in it. Are we doing the right thing? We do go out and about quite a lot, and we've been to visit people. We found these round table sessions pretty successful rather than the more formal ones. But I pick up your point about the individuals, and I think it's a good one, and the experience. But it's very hard to get people of a variety of experience.
And it's difficult also because those people themselves often have a great deal of issues to deal with in their own lives. It makes it difficult for them to come as and when you need them to appear and things like that. The only suggestion I would make to you is the one that we've used ourselves. And as you know, some of our community panel are here today to observe this session. And we face the same issue of how do you access people to come and speak to you, in our case, on a regular basis. And our solution to that is to use somebody with expertise in that field to access those people for you. So in a sense, we use a skilled intermediary.
Yeah.
She is also here today. To do that, because of course we face the same issue as you. You know, we exist in large institutions. How do we access the people who are difficult to find and difficult to, you know, to find the time for that for you? So I would say think about a skilled intermediary.
I'm going to play devil's advocate here, because you're talking of skilled intermediaries.
Yeah.
Skilled intermediaries often put their slant on what the public are actually saying. And we've had experience of this in a number of occasions.
Sorry, I don't mean to use the skilled intermediaries as the voice. I mean to use the skilled intermediaries as the people to access the people so that you hear the real voices. Sorry,
right, okay.
If you misunderstood
that's
me.
Fine.
I agree with you entirely.
Grand. Cameron, do you want to come back?
No, I was just going to come back on the thing about the usual suspects. It's very difficult. I think this skilled intermediary, I understand exactly what you mean. It's like a sort of somebody who's going to actually who's going to lead the discussion. But do you think we're doing the right thing is our committee work very effective, do you think, in the way we're dealing with, if you like, in the way we're dealing with people and engagement? Not just you, but the others. Do they all think we've been very effective?
Anybody got a view on that? I know it's very difficult because you haven't seen us at the coalface, really. Professor Hastings?
Well, I do think that over time there have been big improvements in the extent to which central government has reached out to ordinary people. The work of around the Community Empowerment Act, there was a lot of involvement around that, the Fair Scotland conversations. There are a lot of people, ordinary people in Scotland, whose voices are at least round the table, if not heard to. So I think, you know, there's still room for improvement, but I think we're moving in the right direction, in my view.
Thank you. Okay.
Could I come back on another one? Professor Gibb mentioned this thing about committees interacting with each other, which I think is quite important because we don't tend to deal with planning a lot, whereas other infrastructure does. What would you suggest as a solution to that? Have you any?
That's why I asked the question. I suppose it's thinking of effective ways of co-working, and I think the Chair made a really important point that, of course, you all sit in many committees, so that's an important direct thing that happens. But I suppose it's thinking through what's the most effective ways on a regular weekly basis that committees can interact and share and probably develop your agendas over a period of time in a combined manner.
I don't want to get bogged down in this. I know this is quite important, but I think the Parliament itself is changing in terms of the way that we do interact. There has been much more use of committee debates during the course of this session. I think that's been useful for everyone in that regard. And there have been debates that have been held jointly between committees. I think that's something that we need to explore and deal with in the legacy paper. But I think you make a good point.
I mean, I know something that happens in Westminster. I presume it happens here as well. But they have a committee of conveners, don't they?
We have that together. Here too. There's a meeting of that on Thursday. You've just reminded me that we have that too. Yeah. Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, convener. I was elected to Kilmarnock and Loudoun District Council in 1992. I think it was, and you could argue that was at a time when budgets were a bit more plentiful than they are just now, but I don't have any great recollection of a superb engagement process that really worked with communities and worked on their outcomes and developing all of that. And I saw the beginning of the kind of community planning process there, but my impression of that, and it's still pretty much like that, is that it was things that were to be done to the community. Right, we do things to the community rather than work with them on the way up. So in one of my previous walkabout campaigns in my community, I met quite a wise constituent who said to me, why don't you develop policy from the ground up? And that kind of I think that conversation has been circulating around here in some of the comments and finding ways to do that. And so I was wanting to ask you, does things like mechanisms like the Community Empowerment Bill open the door for that kind of process? Because I don't think resource is the only thing that affects change. I mean, and the lack of it doesn't prevent it. I mean, there's other dynamics, I think, that are involved, and I was hoping that there might be a view on things like the Community Empowerment Bill to see if that really begins to unlock that ability to have policy making from the ground up. And do you think we're on a successful path towards something like that?
Professor Kearns first, please.
I think that depends on its impact upon community planning. And there are two issues I would say about that. I think there isn't enough of what you describe, if you like, community up planning, particularly in two respects. One, which I mentioned in submission, is social planning. There's a lot of physical planning, but not a lot of social planning. How do we want communities to be composed? How do we wish them to function? And I think the planning has to embrace more about the private sector. I think the private sector has really big impacts upon communities that are sort of not quite uncontrollable, but quite difficult to control and influence. And so often public processes influence the provision of public services, and there's this big elephant in the room, if you like, as to what happens in the private sector in relation to retail, leisure, transport. Probably the issue, as we go around our study communities, that again mentions to me more than any other, is how do we get purchase on transport? Those things change. We don't know they're going to change, whether it's trains, buses, whatever, and they impact upon our lives. So I think the question I would pose back is what do you think the impact of the Community Empowerment Act will be upon the community planning process? That seems to me a big question to address in the future.
Who wants to? Dr. White, please.
Just very briefly, I think it's. I think the place standards are really good. As an urban designer, I'm quite interested in the way the place standards are developing, and I'm keen to see kind of its effectiveness. But I think one thing it could be used for, and this kind of links into sort of grassroots policy making, is to engage people in visioning about the places where they live, to capture what they like and what they don't like about places, and to try and come together to have a sort of foundationary understanding about what matters about the place they are and what they want to see it be in the future. We have a lot of local policy, local plans and various mechanisms that support the development and control process. I think perhaps we could do a better job of establishing a true vision that people have developed for what their city, their town, their neighbourhood could be. And I think the place standard potentially provides that mechanism for understanding, if it works. I worry it's a little bit bureaucratic when I've a few tests of it I have seen, that's a bit heavy and could be made less complicated, but I'd like to study it a bit more.
Professor Gibb, please.
I think one of the issues that local communities express a concern about, or there's a perception of a concern, is that they worry that some of the community empowerment in terms of asset transfer is actually to some extent about public agencies washing their hands or pushing down the control and management of certain activities to the community. Now, they may want at one level to make changes to the way that those services or assets are used, but that's quite another matter for thinking about the long-term way in which they're going to manage those assets and actually continue to deliver them. And certainly in what works, we've had a sense from both community planning partnerships and from local communities that there's some concerns about that. The other thing is to mention again participatory budgeting, because it's not just about resource allocation, it's actually about the process that goes with that. I think in the sense again from international research and from research in England that can be, you know, a useful way of bringing more people into thinking about the choices over the way that public resources get used and what services get invested in. And even if it's a relatively modest sum of monies, I think it's going to be, at least in initially, that's a potentially very valuable thing to do.
Professor Hastings, do you want to come in?
I guess I would just add that I think in terms of bottom-up policy making, I think it's important to be quite transparent with the communities you're engaging in those processes around the limits to that participation, what's possible, and particularly not raising aspirations beyond what can actually be delivered through that process.
Willie?
Discussion about, when you think about things like local planning process, convener, where new housing developments appear in towns, and my experience is that the public engagement and interaction with that happens at the tail end of the process, when they don't like something or they want to object to something. But despite great efforts at attempting to engage with the public on a complex matter like the local plan, it by and large doesn't happen particularly successfully. And what you get, in my view, it's a personal view, is that you get, sometimes you get communities that have got peripheral housing, lovely new housing with nothing else in them but houses. There's not, in fact, some examples in my own constituency, there's not even a post box.
I think that's a symptom of the planning process as a whole, which one is at a large scale, even though, you know, it's difficult to engage a community in a plan for the south of Glasgow or the south of Edinburgh when they think they live in a place with a particular name for which there doesn't appear to be a planning process. But then, of course, they look, the devil's in the detail, and there is, and it's in the plan, but they didn't know that it was in the plan. So I think I agree with you about how that isn't particularly an empowering way of doing things, and that you need to change the order in which planning is done. It's done basically from the top down. And as you say, at the tail end, somebody realises there's a bit of development going on in their backyard they didn't know about, as opposed from starting from the from a different building block, if you like. And that's where I think this idea of the place standard, which we've talked about, I think it has potential, but it's currently extremely weak. Mm-hmm. And let's be clear about it. It's entirely voluntary, and there are no minimum standards in it at all. That seems to me to be a big issue for the process as a whole. It is potentially a tool somebody could use for visioning and to work out what they want at a community level, but currently it is entirely tangential to any planning process. And I think the task for a committee like this in local government is to say, can it be brought more integrally into the planning process? At the moment, it sits over there somewhere, and it can be used by a community or not, and nobody cares either way, but it's not part of any process that is the centrally defining process that determines what communities look like in the future, and it's not in there. So as a tool that a community could use, they would face, if they came up with a view about their area on the basis of the place standard, they then have a big task in their hands to say, how do we feed that into a planning process that actually happened last year anyway?
The charrette system is the same. I think the mainstreaming of the charrettes is very interesting, and it's sort of another innovative idea out of the architecture and housing division. But again, they drop in at certain points, and then they disappear. And what I found in my work in Canada is that the effectiveness of their public participation process on the water, it was effective and it involved a lot of people because it started right at the vision and it's continued through all the different plans right to the point where people get involved in the individual buildings. We're quite good at getting people involved in individual buildings that are being proposed or housing estates because often, but sadly, it's often reactionary. It's a negative experience about perhaps not wanting something to be on a piece of land or close to one's house, the sort of NIMBYist idea. If we can get people excited about planning in their neighbourhoods earlier on, I think that's the ticket.
Thank you very much for that.
Okay, John.
Just on that point, and interested in Professor Cairn's comment about the private sector, as a sector that we don't tend to engage with as a committee, and I think we've very seldom engaged with in relation to the looking at particularly community empowerment. But the private sector is a dilemma for many, it's a dilemma for local government, but particularly for local communities. And Dr. White made the reference to the issue about communities being engaged in the planning process, the place standard concept, where communities may have a different concept about how they see their community growing and the demands and the needs of that community, compared to what a private developer, a retailer, or the local authority may see for that community. So it's the thing about how do we get those elements to understand, if we are genuinely talking about community empowerment, how do we get to the stage where the community can make meaningful decisions about how they see their communities being taken forward? I can give you a number of examples at the present moment where in many communities in central Scotland, there is major house building programmes taking place. It's the private sector. Private sector have identified the land. The community demand is they want more social housing. But the private sector don't want to build social housing because it's not as profitable. So how do we get that to the situation where communities can meaningfully engage and give direction to the place standard that can be then put into situation where the communities feel they have actually gained something? Because at the present moment, many communities feel they don't gain anything by being part of the process because the decisions have either been made, as you said, quite rightly said, in the local plan 5 years ago, or made at a planning committee 6 months ago, or has been taken completely out with their control. And the only time they hear of these developments is when developers actually go on site and start laying foundations. So how do we get to that stage where we get those engagements right? But I think it goes back to Professor Hastings' comment about meaningful engagement and people understanding what we mean by engagement.
I'd appreciate brief answers on this because we're getting tight for time. Professor Gibb indicated, please.
To make the point that another important part of the private sector isn't just on the development side, but it's also in the process of care homes and delivering social care. And it takes me back to the integrative point, I guess, again, to the extent to which this committee is involved in health and social care and integration at local government level, which must embrace the kind of role of the private sector and the voluntary sector, indeed, in delivering many of the services that local government requires. I've actually got a PhD student who's just started work on the third sector interface role in community planning partnerships between the whole of the third sector and each local authority level, and that looks like a particularly challenging set of issues there as well.
Dr. White, please.
On a point in relation to how we respond to private sector development, actually, I think there's a case to be made for local government engaging more in physical master planning. That sounds rather top-down, frankly, but actually establishing physical visions with communities for what places are going to look like, where roads are going to go, where services in housing estates are going to go, and playing a more active role in those private sector-led housing schemes would be one method.
Okay. Anyone else want to come? Professor Kearns, please.
I would come back to a point I made earlier about how you give a community more power at a more local level through either the use of place standard or the production of community plans. The way to engage the private sector is both that a community can identify either opportunities, there are some things they want the private sector to do with and for them, and to give them more powers of veto, so there are things they don't want the private sector to do so much, and they should have the power to try to prevent them. They have very few powers of prevention at the moment. Commercial interests are, you know, largely able to pursue their interest even in the face of community opposition to some things, and that shouldn't be the case.
Okay, can I thank you very much for your attendance today? I suspend for a few minutes for a change of witnesses. Thank you.
As discussed earlier in our meeting, we now have former local authority senior officials to give us evidence in our legacy paper. Can I welcome George Black, visiting professor at the University of Strathclyde and former chief executive of Glasgow City Council. Bill Howat, former chief executive of Western Isles and former advisor to this committee. And Gavin Whitefield, former chief executive of North Lanarkshire Council. Gentlemen, if I could ask the same initial question as I asked the previous panel, what do you think characterise this committee's legacy? Mr Whitefield.
Can I start? I think just from a brief review of your work over this term, I think first and foremost it's been about championing the role of communities and the importance of community engagement, and that's seen through the work you've done on public sector reform, on the review of various bills that have come before you, including the Community Empowerment Act, which is always a key strand of that. But also picked up from your questioning, particularly around about community planning, about the importance of councils, all community planning partners, having effective engagement with communities and ensuring that the resources that are available are targeted in the best way to support the priority outcomes that are identified through that process. So I think first and foremost the role of communities is coming through loud and clear, and you've put in place a framework and various mechanisms to ensure that that's built on through the next term. The challenge is going to be obviously seeing that develop against the backdrop of the unprecedented challenge that's there for local authorities, community planning partnerships, with the squeeze in resources, with increasing demand for services and reducing resources. The second legacy that strikes me from listening to the earlier evidence session there is obviously in the work you've done to contribute to the establishment of the Local Tax Commission, which is obviously again set in place a framework which should see changes to the council tax and hopefully a move away from the paralysis that's around the council tax freeze, which is now entering or about to enter its ninth year. So I think that's something that's obviously going to be very welcomed in terms of getting a fairer system, but also getting a system which can be used to start to resource and start to target some of the gaps in funding which are there for the foreseeable future in terms of public sector funding.
Thank you. Mr Black, please.
Well, the comments I would make that the workload that are the areas that you have looked at over the last 5 years makes an impressive reading, the list that you provided. And I think a legacy for yourself will be that the challenges that you have in the future will be greater than the challenges you've had in the last 5 years. So the experience you'll have gained in dealing with the issues over that period should stand you in good stead for what's to come.
Thank you. Mr Howat, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Can I just reinforce, I agree entirely with what both Gavin and George have had to say. For me, having had the pleasure and privilege of sitting on the other side of the table, you yourself and your vice-convener have already summarised some of the key legacies that I think you will leave behind. Your very refreshing approach towards taking evidence, your efforts to get out and talk to people, and even in the questioning I've heard today, your attempt to avoid the usual suspects. I'm sorry you've got three more in front of you. And I hope in drawing up your legacy paper, you will highlight the efforts to do that. Having sat with you, I know also that you've taken a very challenging approach, and I wholly endorse that. I think that's the main purpose of parliamentary committees, and indeed in some senses I would suggest that if you can, you should pass on to your successors the view that you can be even more challenging in the future. I think the third thing I would say, and you would expect the former chief executive Colin and Leland-Shear to say this, but you yourself, convener, summed it all up when you said, having heard evidence from so many different sources, that Scotland is a very diverse place. One size does not fit all. And for the benefit of those members who, there are four members here who didn't, were new to me to the committee, can I make the point that I actually spent 20 years as a civil servant sitting in Edinburgh, dreaming up some of the top-down solutions that haven't worked. So I have had experience on both sides of this fence. And I think your questioning of the academics who were here highlighted probably another area that I would just like to finish on. In passing on your legacy, I hope that you will draw out some principles to guide your successors rather than focus on highlighting specific issues. I'm happy to elaborate on that if you wish, but let me give you just one example that follows from a question that I heard John Wilson ask, which was, how do we improve engagement? And the answer I think you all know anyway. Engagement comes best when people think it matters. It's as simple as that. That's why in the planning process, to go back to the questions you asked, why is it people don't get engaged till they find out that there's going to be a swimming pool or a pub or a casino landing on their doorstep? And chances are they've never really understood it. They've only just found out. And the biggest evidence I would suggest for that is the referendum that we had. 85% turnout. Why? Because people thought their votes mattered. And I think that's the level that you should be thinking about passing on your legacy, the legacies of challenge, of finding out community engagement, and above all, finding ways that people will actually feel that in expressing their views, they will be heard, listened to, and addressed.
Thank you. I want to touch upon some of the areas that you were involved in, Mr. Howat, and that was round about our public service reform inquiry, a fairly big piece of work over three strands. It seemed at the time that we were trying to build on the Christie Commission recommendations, but often what we would find is, you know, we were seeing scenarios where we were reinventing the wheel in places. How do we ensure, and we have attempted to do so, how do we ensure that best practice is exported across the country? I understand what you said earlier about there's no two places the same, but there are things which happen right across the country which are almost the same. How do we ensure that we export best practice? How have we done in trying to make sure that that's the case? How can our successors do better?
Again, I would go back to a generality, if I may, convener, and again, I hope this will feature in the introduction to your legacy paper. I think the first thing that anybody has to do when they address the question of how do you change something is to have a good understanding of what the current context is. And I think it will be important to your successors that you leave behind an explanation more than just the 5 years that you've covered. I would go further than that if I were you. In fact, I would encourage you to go back 20 years. 20 years this year will be the last reorganisation of local government. A lot of what we are looking at and what you have heard today flows from that reorganisation. And I would encourage you to look at that. I would encourage you to look at the changes that have happened since that reorganisation. I would encourage you to think about questions like, how local is local government these days? Because there have been some pretty fundamental changes. And some of the things that you've just said, I think when you put that into that context, you will find there's a lot of well-meaning people out there in all councils, in councillors as well. And I know some of you have been councillors, so you will know what goes on within councils. You will know the efforts that are made to communicate, to represent people, to speak up for people. And yet, if you'll excuse me making the point, Willie made the point as a man, as a councillor coming in as a councillor, felt that things were being done to the community and not for the community. And yet you were the councillor representing that community. So, how do you, I think the point I'm trying to make here is that there's a lot of goodwill out there. There is a lot of people trying to do best practice. There is a thing called the Improvement Service. There are all those academics. There are various think tanks. You yourselves have tried to promote this in your efforts going around the country. I know that by your round tables, by trying to get people to talk together. I don't have a magic bullet on this one. I don't think anyone does. The processes are there. They're well tried. I think what you can do is give them a greater sense of direction and, above all, that context in which things are happening.
Thank you. Mr. Black, please.
I would encourage you to make contact with professional associations like SOLAS, ADES. I don't think there's a great track record of best practice being shared across the public sector, and certainly in my experience there are always reasons why there's a local circumstance which makes it difficult to implement something which is working in a different part of the country. But looking ahead, I do think that there will be a greater willingness to adopt best practice, because every public authority will be looking to redesign the services they are providing to live within their reduced finances. And I do not think that people will have the time to look to reinvent everything themselves. And I think there will be more of a willingness to take what works in different parts of the country and implement that. And I would think that in health and social care, that will be particularly the case. The timescales there and the pressures there, I think, will demand that there's a more of a uniformity across the country in certain services.
Thank you. Mr. Whitefield, please.
Yep, I think I agree with all that with George and Bill have outlined there, in particular emphasising the importance of being aware of what's already in place to drive that sharing of best practice through the Improvement Service, through SOLAS, through the other professional associations and through the Scottish Leaders Forum and a whole host of other networks. But I would perhaps point out that there's a link here with the work you've been doing on the progress on benchmarking and performance reporting, and that a sense that one of the real important areas going forward will be to get a clearer sense of where outcomes are not as good as they should be, and having that benchmarking information should provide a clearer focus for the Parliament, for local councils, for other bodies to identify where, as a result perhaps of not best practice not having been implemented, outcomes are not as they should be. But a sense we're on a journey which needs to be accelerated as quickly as possible to ensure that information is available, because I think at the moment you see comments made about community planning partnerships, picking up a reference that was made, I think one of the inquiries is some being viewed as talking shops. I certainly, in my experience, and I know a substantial number of my other colleagues, they don't view it that way. They view community planning as being at the heart of service development and delivery, and focusing on outcomes. But I think the challenge going forward is to get a clearer picture of where those outcomes are not as good as they should be, and then focusing in on what action needs to be taken to address that.
Let's look at benchmarking. It took a substantial amount of time to get to the place that we are now at with SOLAS and the Improvement Service interacting with one another to come up with what are the best indicators. Do you think that maybe there was a little bit more impetus put into that when this committee started to take much more of an interest?
I wasn't involved in the interaction with the committee directly through SOLAS at that time, but what I can say is that SOLAS have recognised for some time the importance of moving away from what were the previous key performance indicators, where there were a number which were, you know, the value of which was questionable. So there was a real commitment to move this agenda forward as quickly as possible. I really can't say whether the committee added, you know, any further impetus to that. The commitment I was aware was already there.
Mr. Howat.
Gavin is absolutely right. The commitment was there, and indeed you've had two advisers in Alec and myself who were central to driving that forward. Alec was the driving force, and I came in behind him. By that time I was retired and came to help. There were two major step changes in driving that forward. One was when the Audit Commission, Audit Scotland, agreed that the SOLAS approach was the correct approach and that they were willing to work with them. And the second was when this committee took an interest, because it then became much more public at a time when a great deal of the work had been going on behind the scenes. So the short answer to your question, in my view, would be yes. I think that, as Gavin said,
This was entirely agreed by Solace. It was entirely agreed through the Improvement Service. It eventually came through COSLA, and everyone came on side, and you were a central part to that.
Do you think Audit Scotland were an impediment at certain points in coming up with the indicators?
I'm sorry, by the time they got to the stage of doing the indicators, convener, I had stepped down from my role, so I can't speak for the actual process. When I was stepping down from my Solace role, we had reached the stage where, from memory, we had developed, I think it was 32 initially, and at that time, Audit Scotland were engaging with the Improvement Service to refine them. I may say, I'm not trying to defend anyone here, but if anyone hasn't gotten involved with statisticians and working through, and indeed accountants and all the other people that do the bean counters, I'll be rude, the bean counters. It gets to a point George made earlier about you have a good idea at one level, and then you start to take it down through all the other levels, and you run into all the different views, the vested interests, sometimes perfectly valid views. I'm not decrying people here, but once you start to drive something down from the top, it can take a long time, and sometimes for valid reasons.
Mr. Black and then Mr. Whitefield, please.
If I could just make a comment about Audit Scotland, that I think they had concerns about how sustainable the new benchmarking would be, and they were concerned that the ownership would be taken up by chief executives and would be sustained over a period, because their indicators were statutory indicators rather than what you might say voluntary indicators. So I think there was a lot of work was carried out to give a reassurance to Audit Scotland that there was a real commitment. But if I could come back to you were talking about sharing best practice, indicators in my view will only be important if people look beneath the figures, look what actually is making the figures outturn at a certain level, and look at the practice on the ground which leads to that. And if they can improve their performance by adopting best practice from elsewhere, then that will be a success. The numbers in themselves just allow you to open the can and have a look at what's in there.
Thank you. I think the committee has picked up on that, and it is all about the service that's being delivered to the public. And I know that some folk think that benchmarking is a bit of a dry topic for us to have looked at, but it is all about delivery to the folks out there. Mr. Whitefield.
Yeah, it was really just along the lines of what George has outlined there, that I didn't sense that Audit Scotland were in any way a barrier or slowed the process. They were very interested and very keen to see the matter benchmarking be put in place as quickly as possible. So I don't sense that there was any delays there as a consequence of Audit Scotland's role.
They just seem to like some of the old indicators, like how many library books are borrowed per 1,000 people, which is kind of relevant nowadays in some regards about library usage. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to pick up on a point that Gavin Whitefield made, and that's the community planning partnerships. And basically, your words, Gavin, were service development and delivery. Now, this committee over the past period has looked at community planning partnerships. We've made comments on community planning partnerships. Does any of the panel think the discussions we were having here in this committee played any part in influencing the work that was being done by community planning partnerships throughout Scotland? Because part of what I'm trying to examine is we're having discussions here, we're making recommendations, we're producing reports. Does that have any impact on how local authorities then deliver the services? Do they start tweaking those services, or do they just continue on regardless?
We should add changing legislation to John's list as well. Mr. Whitefield first, please.
I think community planning partnerships will draw in information from all different sources to inform how they develop their practice. So yes, the committee's deliberations and those of Audit Scotland, of the other agents, other inspectorate, it will have an impact. These will be reflected on, and they will be taken account of in developing what's best for that local community planning partnership. But it was interesting in the earlier discussion about the importance of not just having a good strategic planning mechanism in place for community planning partnerships in North Lanarkshire. It was the North Lanarkshire Partnership Board, which had involvement from two representatives on the board from the third sector, from Strathclyde Passenger Transport. We talked about the importance of transportation in local communities. But beyond that, we'd also developed six local area partnerships where the intention was to replicate the same representation at that local level with all key community planning partners working with community forums at that local level. And then beyond that, identifying one of the neighbourhoods where there had been a deterioration in the deprivation statistics of that area and a real concentration in that area at a neighbourhood level. And a sense that that sort of approach is being developed and across Scotland, recognising that it's not just about having community planning at the strategic level. Most important part is having it at a local level and making a difference at a local level.
I should have made a declaration, Convener. I was a councillor under Gavin's stewardship when he was the chief executive in North Lanarkshire, so I am well aware of some of the local planning meetings and the local area partnership meetings. So, but if anybody else has got to.
Mr. Howat, please.
Convener, I've been retired 10 years, so, and I was your advisor on this one, so I think I should pass this to George, quite frankly.
Passing the buck, Mr. Black.
Well, it goes without saying that the Local Government and Regeneration Committee are an important body in terms of the work that goes on around the country. My experience, chief executives look at what all committees of Scottish Parliament are looking at and use that in terms of helping them and advising the council on the priorities that they should be looking at looking forward. So a lot of times councils will actually be proactive in saying, if these are the areas which are important around the country, what are we doing at a local level, and making sure that when a report comes out from your committee that they are on the mark there and they're not starting way back in terms of having considered the issues. So I think, as I say, I repeat myself, it goes without saying that attention will be paid to what you are looking at. And I guess if I was asking, putting a question to you, that if you are finding that witnesses are, you have no difficulty in getting people to give evidence, then that, to my mind, would be a statement as to how important you are viewed around the country. If you start to get difficulty in finding people coming forward, that is when you should be looking at what you're doing.
Well, some folk have tried to dodge the bullet and have tried not to come, but I have to say, in all fairness, under your stewardship at Glasgow, Mr. Black, we had no problem whatsoever in getting witnesses from Glasgow City. John.
Thank you, Convener. Just as a follow-up in relation to, you all heard the earlier questioning that we did with the academics in terms of the main thrust, I think it's fair to say, of this committee has been trying to push engagement of communities in the process and in the decision-making process and the planning process. And part of the work of the committee in terms of community empowerment legislation that was going through the report, quite rightly, I would say, argued for a strong case for communities to be involved in that right from the start. Do you think that element has been taken on board by the whole range of agencies, local authorities, community planning partnerships, local area partnerships, and others, area management committees, I think Glasgow still calls them, in relation to engaging with communities? Do you think enough has been done to address some of the issues that have been identified in relation to, because we did, certainly when we were carrying out our inquiry, we went out to govern, and we certainly heard very vocal community activists about the role of Glasgow City Council or the lack of the role of Glasgow City Council in relation to engaging with those communities and looking at the value that they deliver as communities in terms of services, vital services in these communities, but felt they were being excluded or from the debate or not being listened to by the local authority in terms of taking forward their issues.
Mr. Black, please.
I would say that there has been progress in community planning in engaging with communities over the years, but clearly much more has to take place. One of the issues in Glasgow stating the obvious, is that the size of Glasgow, when I was chief executive, there were 10 community planning partnerships. Well, that still means that you've got 60,000 residents in that area. So engaging at a very local level was something which was quite a challenge. There was reference made in the previous evidence to thriving places, and that was at an early stage when I was chief executive. But that was trying to look right down at what people would recognise as a local community and then engaging with that local community. The only other point I would make is, again, looking ahead to the challenges ahead and the financial challenges, that communities, I think, will be more willing or more demanding in being involved in processes, because there will be a greater awareness of the level of change that's going to take place right across the public sector and impacting on their local community. And I think they will demand that all organisations are engaging with them, health, police, fire, local authorities, in a coordinated way. And that's where I think local community planning partnerships have a key role to play.
Mr. Whitefield.
Yes, Convener, I agree that there's, you know, absolute commitment at a local level to community engagement, and I think a similar level of frustration this committee has had regarding the fact that, you know, there can be, it can be done better, but it does rely on people coming forward and being willing to engage. And I think it was interesting in the earlier session, I think the point that Jane Baxter made about the fact, the important role that the MSPs play. MSPs are in the community, councillors are in the community, they're in the supermarket, they're in the street, they're hearing, they're talking to people, and councillors at a local level, MSPs at a national level, are the people who are then taking account of those views and shaping policy, strategy and legislation.
Mr. Howat.
Convener, if I do hark back to my time in Corlin and Elinshire, can I use that as an illustration of one of the issues I know that we, you as a committee, have grappled with, particularly in the community planning context, and that is the use of the word community. I mean, listening to the debate today, I hear some very general language about community engagement. But as you yourself said at the beginning, Scotland is very diverse. In my time in the Western Isles, our communities were very vocal. We had 31 councillors. We had 31 community councils. We actually devolved certain functions to the community councils, and that gets me to the point I was making to John. You allocate a budget to a group of people, albeit it was very small. This was mostly about burial grounds, which are a very big issue in the Western Isles, let me tell you. And suddenly you get real community engagement. A place like the Western Isles, there is a very clear sense of local identity. As if any of you go there, you will know that. It's a very different place from somewhere like Glasgow or North Lanarkshire. And it's interesting to hear George saying that in Glasgow, he's got 10 community planning partnerships. 10. Now, that's 600,000 or something, George, from memory. So about 60,000 in each. Any one of those is nearly three times the whole of the Western Isles. So I think you need to be careful in the use of language here. And that's why at the beginning I was saying, please, in your legacy paper, set the context and recognise that something that works in one place, as George was saying, might not translate as readily. Does the Western Isles Community Planning Partnership have regard to this committee? Absolutely. But it will do it in the way that George has suggested. It will be the chief executive and the officials of the various organisations who will bring the papers to the committee. They will have regard to it. And then it comes up from the bottom. And what comes down from the top doesn't always play well down at the bottom, as you're well aware, when you get out there. And people react to it. And that's, I think, what I'm saying about context. And that's going to play out differently in different parts of Scotland. And I think it's important, if that is your experience, I know that from working with you. I know that when I was working with you, we had a debate about what are communities. Communities aren't necessarily localities. There are communities of common interest. They have to you have to have regard to them as well. So it's a complex business. And that's why, sorry to go back to my starting point, but that's why I think you, in handing over your legacy, you should be drawing out some general principles and giving some guidance as to what are the issues that the next committee would want to address.
John?
I think Mr. Howitt's last comments here, and I think that we could go into debate about the coterminous boundaries of the health board, the local authority, and how that works, and it doesn't work so well in other areas when you're talking about community planning partnerships, when you call in the police, health boards, other services coming into that. But can I just focus on terms of, and once again, draw from my own experience of a community that's tries to be very actively engaged. And we went as a committee through the whole process of the community empowerment report, the bill, and now the Act. But is there a view out there that local authorities hold back from being proactive in developing strategies? Because I've just heard a report earlier this week, or the end of last week, which says that one local authority in terms of community empowerment is effectively saying, oh, we'll just hold back till the government issues the guidance. And it's just trying to work out, we're trying to hopefully give everybody who will listen a steer in terms of the debates, the evidence, the witnesses that we call before us, to hopefully get some organisations, particularly local authorities, to become more proactive in their approach rather than wait on government legislation or government guidance. And do you think that those issues are being taken on board by local authorities? Because, as I said, my experience and what I was told last week is clearly some local authorities, despite all the good work of the committee and the evidence we heard, are still saying we'll just wait till the government provides the guidance.
Mr. Whitefield first, please.
I think, repeat what I said earlier, I think a lot of what's set out in community empowerment and the backdrop to that in terms of improving community engagement, there is an absolute commitment to as a key element of community planning, really, what community planning is already about. So I don't know, obviously, the authority that's been referred to. I can only refer to my experience within in North Lanarkshire. And certainly in North Lanarkshire from, I think it was February of last year, there was a corporate working group established to track the final stages of the bill and ensuring that the authority and indeed the community planning partnership was geared up to deal with all of the consequences of that and address the opportunities that are set out there. Just before I retired, we have a senior management briefing with over 100 senior managers from right across the council, and a key presentation as part of that was on the community empowerment. So there was a recognition of the wide-ranging measures included within the Act and how these would require to be addressed. I think the challenge going forward will be addressing these against the backdrop of unprecedented challenges that continue on council budgets.
Mr. Black, please.
I think it's a matter of degree. I would be surprised if any council was sitting completely in their hands when they knew something was going to be happening. It's more a case of that you progress that issue, and there may well be that you haven't actually finalised the detail because you know guidance is coming. But I come back to my point about professional associations with linkages to civil servants will be well aware of the main thrust of changes that are coming and should be keeping a pace with that. So if I took health and social care integration, I mean, it was some time before actually it was on the statute books, but there was nobody who was sitting waiting at hitting the statute books before they started making preparations. So people were progressing, and I would accept that some authorities will progress more than others, depending on local priorities at the time.
Mr. Howat, please.
Convener, if I may, can I take off my ex-chief executive hat and put on my ex-civil servant hat? 32 councils in Scotland, George's point is absolutely valid. They will all progress at different speeds and in different ways. And going back to your own point, they're all very different and they will all have different views on how any piece of guidance or legislation will be implemented. During my civil service career, I had the misfortune to lead the team that introduced best value in Scotland. Gavin in particular will remember me for that one, I think. And that was a very interesting exercise because there you had 32 councils all behaving very differently. It took us quite a long time to get any kind of consistency across the board. The danger, convener, and as a committee, again, I go back to your legacy, the danger of any piece of guidance or any piece of legislation is that it becomes tick box. That was when best value started to grind to a halt, when we started to give people checklists. And suddenly people said, yes, I've done that, and the whole concept of best value then ground to a halt, because what was supposed to happen was it was supposed to pervade everything councils did. And what happened was people were allocated jobs to say, we've jumped over those hoops. Now, I think it's moved on a lot since then. I'm talking about the very early days. But I think that probably illustrates the point that George is making. And I think from George's joint smile, he's probably experienced that as well.
Premier, it's just that there was 32 different interpretations of best value that was out there. Probably indeed. More than that. But that's another story.
George Adam, please.
Convener, I was just going to say, just from what you said there, Bill, about the fact, my experience in local authority, I was, when they try to devolve things down to the local area committees and things like that, you know, as convener of one, I tried to engage and make sure that they were involved, but all they seemed to be interested in was a grant allocation at the end of the meeting, as opposed to what was happening during the meeting, and almost got to a stage where I had to point out, this is very important, but is it not the way we engage as well with the public when we have these types of meetings where the whole idea is that they're meant to engage with us? Because although they're the usual suspects a lot of the time, they don't know how to translate a council officer's the interpretation of what the issue is into normal kind of English, day-to-day plain English. And it's almost a difficult way to try. It almost becomes like a tick box. And that officer is quite happy that that's been passed to all the local area committees, but the public don't really know what's happening. And is that not the problem, where we don't actually communicate in a way that, you know, without somebody actually saying, getting a big Acme Looney Tunes finger and going, this is an issue, can you deal with this? Is that not the problem?
I'm laughing at the Looney Tunes finger there. The committee has tried to get folk to use plain language. Gentlemen, do you have comment on that? Because, you know, there are times where we here get papers from councils, we get them from here as well, it has to be said, where you're looking 2, 3, 4 times before you're actually getting the gist of it, and in some cases, not getting the gist at all. Who's going first? Bill?
Well, I think since George addressed it to me, I'll take the starter. The gentlemen in each side of me have more immediate experience of this. I entirely sympathise, as you're well aware, convener, from my time as your advisor. I totally agree. This harks back to comments that were made by the academic panel, who were saying that it's one thing to engage, but unless people understand the context, sorry to use the word again, but unless people understand the context of what's happening and understand what influence they can have over it, then sometimes engagement can be sometimes counterproductive. If people are called to a meeting where they think their views will mean a change in something, whereas all that's happening is they're being advised of a change and they might get a chance to comment on it, then you're on a sticky wicket. So I think you are absolutely correct. But that, I think, can only come down to best practice, to experience, to better education. And in terms of what you do as a committee, in the community engagement that you're doing and getting, you know, shall we say, the lesser suspects rather than the usual suspects, I think that's a big step forward. If people think, if the word starts to get out that you can come in front of this committee and express your views and they will be heard and reacted and fed back into the system, then that's a good thing. But the key point there, as you'll notice I said, was fed back into the system. People have to understand that they don't come in front of this committee and say X, Y, or Z, and you're going to say, oh, you're right, we'll get something done about that. They have to understand what happens once you're here. And that's true of anything. I thought the examples from planning were interesting, where the planning system is set up in such a way that somebody, I mean, sitting here today, I can dream up anything I like, go to the relevant council and get outline planning permission almost immediately. I don't have to consult anybody. I can get a start in the process. There's some discontinuity in there. That said, one word of caution, I was interested in the Canadian gentleman's experience where he said visioning things. Visioning things is one thing. Once they become practical reality, it's usually something very different, and you can bet your boots somebody out there wasn't part of the vision. So I think we have to recognise that the systems that we have, however imperfect, have been built up over a long period of time, and we have to improve in them, and it's getting people to understand that. Just one final point, can I make? I'm sure my colleagues will agree. One of the biggest problems in local government, and indeed any public service, I suspect, is that most of the public only engage with it when they need it. I mean,
I think one thing, Mr. Howat, which I think I've got to say is that appearing in front of this committee often can lead to quite substantial change quite quickly. And I'll give you an example of our visit to Dumfries and two things there. In front of the committee,
there was a gentleman from the Scottish Woodlot Association, and that evidence led to a very swift amendment to the Community Empowerment Bill to advance the cause of smallholders and forestry. And also in that visit, we came across a difficulty with an organisation called The Usual Place and a lease. And with our intervention, we managed to get the council to resolve that too. So I think that it's not just entering the system and the sausage factory somewhere. I think we've got to, in our legacy, also show that coming here does often make tangible change to folks' circumstances.
I accept that entirely, Convener. These are very good examples, but my point was a general one of principle, I'm sure you'll appreciate.
Sure,
indeed. About the processes of government.
Thank you. Gavin?
Very little to add. I think it's important that in all mechanisms for engagement that we're using plain English, we're not entering into the language of local government or health or police or whatever, where people are able to go to meetings and understand and relate to the issues that are being debated and contribute to that. And part of the process there is about, you know, building up capacity, building up the understanding of the system. I think there's often an assumption that because somebody who's very engaged through a local community organisation will, through that engagement, already be aware of how the council operates or how community planning operates. And in North Lanarkshire, one of the recent developments is an induction programme for community planning to address that particular issue and ensure that everybody's operating at the same, with the same level of expertise.
Mr. Black.
I wouldn't deny that improvements can be made in communication in plain English, but my experience is that the greater frustration people found in engaging with the system was the complexity. So when you got involved in an issue in a short meeting, it was quite difficult for officers to explain the context of what you're looking at, and particularly when you get into finance and you get the difference between capital and borrowing, operating expenditure, the ring-fenced housing account, and what you can do under the rules that exist. I think people find that frustrating. And what we found was that when you engage people in, it was part of the budget process, in an all-day session where part of it was helping people understand the wider context, that people's priorities were affected as a result of that. If you asked them, you know, what was your priority, education or social work, etc., what you might get from just a person in the street would be different than once they understood what the real choices were and the implications of that. So I wouldn't deny communication is an issue, but I think frustration is more trying to come to grips with a quite complex system.
Period would have been the single outcome agreements, would have been an example of something that was important to the members of said local area committee, but they tended to just fly through it because it was a very formal, almost tick box type, and the councillors knew on the committee exactly what it meant, but it wasn't as easy to translate that. And I kept, a frustrating thing for me was to try and create a debate around it was difficult because you couldn't really hang it on to the actual agenda item that was there. And that's the kind of thing I'm talking about, just to create the debate so we don't have them turning up with the burning torches, like a Universal horror film in the 1950s, you know, but when something does happen, they've already had the opportunity to actually discuss and have the debate. And I think a lot of times, if we can find a way to have the debate before it gets to the change of service, it makes it a lot easier for everyone, you know, try and get some community buy-in, which is something we often hear about, but we don't often experience.
If I could just clarify, there were no burning torches in Glasgow.
George hits upon a point as well, though, in terms of the use of those three words, single outcome agreement. It's kind of difficult to explain to folk what that actually is. And again, it's the use of language that can often be the off-putter right at the very beginning. I'm seeing nodding heads.
I think even worse, it would probably be referred to as an SOA.
Yes.
You know, acronyms are just widespread.
Bill?
I recall, Convener, having a discussion with your committee during our time where we were actually trying to get the witnesses to tell us what they thought an outcome was. And we got some quite varied answers, as I recall.
I remember that session. It was somewhat bizarre, if I remember rightly. Jane Baxter, please.
It's about the use of acronyms and initials, and because when Bill said best value, I used to be a community planning officer. In my head, I went the four C's of best value, and I can't remember what they are, but it was drummed into us. There was four C's of it, which I can't recall, but so it wasn't very good. My learning wasn't very good, but we use these. It's not about understanding, it's about being able to say to the mantra of it rather than understanding what these things mean. And that applies to those who are charged with implementing policies and also with the community that's charged with being on the receiving end of them.
Yeah. Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks again, convener. I'm very interested in looking ahead, perhaps 5 years from now. And I know, take the point about we should perhaps look back 20 years when local government was established and see how well it's working. But in looking ahead 5 years and trying to set out these principles that you mentioned, Bill, about what we could inject into our work in the next 5 years, I would really like us, if we are sitting here in 5 years, to look back and see that we did move things on, we did see better engagement with the public and participation and all of those words that sound great but sometimes don't mean very much. So I'm keen to find out from you if you think things like the Empowerment Bill do give us the opportunity to develop and make progress there, because my view at the moment is that the public are very much still drawn into these systems and processes that are determined by the council, for example. So you're drawn into discussions and processes on their terms, and in that sense I think the public don't feel that they control that or they do have any power over it. Is there any way of trying to really empower the communities through things like the Empowerment Bill that will begin to open up that process, and we can actually perhaps see the community shaping policy development from the ground up in the future?
Can I first of all explain when I said set a context, and my starting point would be 1996, I wasn't suggesting you do a full-scale review of everything that happened, but I think it would be interesting to ask some questions, and I'll happily elaborate on them if you wish. I think the difficulty that you face in the question that you pose, Willie, is that you, as a committee, you have contributed to, developed. Parliament has passed something called a Community Empowerment Bill. That is now a piece of legislation. That will have a guidance attached to it. It may well have secondary legislation. I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with the detail of the bill. I know the principles. And that then puts it into the very system that you've just described. Yes, you as a committee can... have people in here over the next 5 years, you can ask them what they're doing to fulfil the requirements of the bill, but you have to recognise that the very fact that you've put it into a legislative framework makes it part of the system. Whereas a lot of the work that I've seen you do and been part of you doing over the last 5 years was actually breaking out of the system. It was actually getting people to come here who wouldn't otherwise be here and encouraging them to say the things that they felt otherwise couldn't be said. I have vivid memories of the man from the east end of Glasgow sitting somewhere about there, wee Jimmy, who was asked what was the difference between gear and the Clyde Gateway. Ah. And he summed it up in a sentence. He said, well, the first lot came with a pile of money and told us how they were going to spend it. This lot came with a pile of money and asked us how we would like to spend it. And to me, that was quite refreshing. He put it in a nutshell, and it was, and I know that the members of the committee at that time were all very impressed by the fact that the Gateway people brought him along. I'm not sure they were sure what he was going to say, quite frankly. but what he said was fascinating. And I think that's where your work has been so good over the last 5 years and where you wanted to push it. In a sense, you have not bound yourselves, but by having the Empowerment Bill, people are going to be look at what is the legislative framework. And the questioning you've been putting to us today and all the thrust that I've heard with the earlier session is you're wanting people to work together, to learn from best practice, to interact and to get wider engagement. And I, as I said right at the beginning, I don't have any silver bullets or magic bullets that will solve that one for you. And a lot of what you've heard is stuff that's been done before. So I don't know where the magic is, other than what I said to John right at the beginning. If people think their view matters, they will engage. And that, to me, is such a simple principle that if you can take that and run forward with it, set in the right context, then you will have a big, big impact.
George, please.
And If I look at the information you provided in terms of the issues you were thinking about looking at, council tax reform, health and social care integration, community empowerment and city deals, these are all relevant to the public sector, big, meaty issues, but they're also relevant to individuals. I mean, any reform of local taxation will get a lot of attention from individuals. Health and social care integration, one of the big challenges there will be when they redesign services that are redesigned involving people and what works for them, individuals. If you look at community empowerment, there's a great deal of expectation against that bill, and probably the biggest challenge is actually delivering on that expectation. If there was one area if we were looking at that I would encourage you to look at in the next 5 years, it would be how much has been done or is being done on early intervention. The Christie Commission came out, if my memory serves me, it'll be 5 years ago in the summer. And with the financial challenges that are ahead, you've got the reduced budgets, but you've also got increasing demand. And if all authorities do, and it will be a big do, is address the financial challenges, but don't address the demands that are coming down the road by looking at early intervention measures, then the problems in 5 years' time will be even greater. So I would encourage you to look at that, because that, I think, would lead to a greater emphasis being put on early intervention by authorities, harking back to the conversation we had earlier about what you have in your agenda tends to feed through to what people are looking at.
Gavin, please.
Answer to the question about, you know, in 5 years' time, what would this committee want to see as an outcome? I think it's important to recognise that, you know, you look at community empowerment, you look at the health and care integration, all the items that you've identified as the big issues, which I would agree with over the next 5 years. But a lot of these are a means to an end. The end is, you know, better services, better outcomes against the backdrop of massive financial pressures. So I think if I was here, I would want to be able to say at the start of the term, if you look at the priorities that are set at a national level, and you look at the priorities at local community planning partnerships, there might be different terminology, but they all come back to, you know, better health and care, better health and well-being, lifelong learning, better educational attainment, regeneration and improved employment opportunities and reducing unemployment, community safety in terms of reducing crime levels and better safety outcomes in the roads and homes, and also addressing inequality. And I come back to my earlier point about, you know, getting in place through the benchmarking framework, through the single outcome agreements, a clear picture of where things stand at the start of the next parliamentary term and where you'd want to see them at the end in this committee, using all of the focus round about the areas you've identified to support that process. One area I thought might also be a specific area you might want to give consideration to is in terms of the regeneration remit you have, that you've looked very much a sense at community regeneration, but maybe merit, and again this links in with one of your other committees, about the role of infrastructure investment in supporting regeneration outcomes, where you've got projects, again I relate to my own experience in North Lanarkshire, like Ravenscraig, the city deal, and maybe rather than just looking at city deal, looking at all of the infrastructure investment that's been made and how has that been best channelled to support the better outcomes I've already referred to.
Willie?
I mean, do you think, I mean, the ordinary man and woman in the street and places like my constituency in Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley are looking at all these systems and processes just now and the community empowerment bill and all the rest of it and going, great, we are now getting a chance to really influence things. I suppose I'm kind of looking for the magic ingredient that makes that happen and how we can maybe move towards that. I don't get the sense that that's the case yet. I hope it might be, but I don't get the sense that the public are saying, brilliant, this is really going to give us a chance to influence things at Scottish Parliament or our local council. And I suppose I'm kind of asking for your help here to point us in that direction, what that might be, what that catalyst might be to get them to engage with us.
Who's going to take a crack at that first?
It's got to matter to them. And we think all of the work that we do matters to individuals. It's sometimes they don't know that we're doing it, or it's too late, or it's halfway through. And how do we do it better, earlier, quicker, smarter, all of that? You know?
Make a stab. I think it comes back to the point about language. That the two city deals, for example, well, what does city deal mean to, you know, somebody who's not involved in that? But if the language is about jobs, opportunities for youngsters, that type of language, I think it's easier to get people engaged in that. So that's, I think, a challenge for politicians turning it back, is that how do they take the language which we all work in and turn it into something which is relevant to people? And Bill's point about the guy from the East End coming along, well, he understood what it was about, you know, the difference between Gear and the Clyde Gateway in his language. He understood it clearly. So that's a good example of, I think, being able to get over to people why it matters to them.
He most certainly did understand as well. Gavin, Bill, have you got anything to add to that?
Not to add, other than, again, listening to the earlier discussion round about this issue. Obviously, it's an area we'll have thought about, but you know, we're in a completely different place now in terms of the technology available to get that engagement through social media, digital, and rather than reflecting back on, well, where we were 20 years ago and thinking about meetings and arrangements and how you engage with people, I think the technology we have now provides massive opportunities to embrace that in a way which will give more power to what's already set out in the legislation and its impact.
Bill?
Just a thought, listening to Willie. First, I'm sorry, Willie, I think you're absolutely right in saying it's highly unlikely that the ordinary person in the street in the Doon Valley is rubbing their hands in glee. But the thought crossed my mind that maybe that gentleman from the East End of Glasgow, if we could find a few champions like him, who, not officials like us, maybe not even councillors, but people who are directly community representatives who would be willing to go out and actually explain it in language that other people could understand. That might be one way forward. But again, I come back to what I've been saying all the way through this. At the end of the day, when you go out to somebody in the street and say to them, here's an issue, it happens in a context, and that context can be quite complicated. You yourself have highlighted it. George has done it quite graphically. I know that when our council didn't get involved in this, but I know that after I retired, many councils in Scotland have been going through annually a budget consultation exercise where leaders, finance conveners, chief executives, directors of finance are going out and saying to people, here's where it's at, outlining the kind of choices that maybe Gavin and George might want to reflect on those. But at the end of the day, as George rightly said, that's ending up in an argument about what's going into which budget. It's not getting to what you want to do or what the rest of you want to do in terms of actual outcomes. It's a budget consultation exercise. But that's engaging the public, I think, far more, because at the end of the day, get back to my starting point, people think it matters and their voices are being heard. And that's the key to all of this.
Okay.
Thank you.
In terms of Willie's last question, without the Community Empowerment Act being in place, there are many organisations throughout the country and many local authorities where communities are already running various organisations and are in charge of the budget, and yet they seem to be hidden from view in some regards. How do we communicate that sometimes it's not necessarily a change in legislation that's required, but a change in attitude in certain places? And also beyond that, the powers that be trusting local folk to be able to do what's right for them and controlling those resources. Em, do you want to take a stab at that?
Can I be controversial?
It's not like you, Bill, but on you go, aye.
I think you can set an example. One of the reasons I would like you to set a context for what's happened since 1996 is that if you go back over it, I think you will find there's been a process of centralisation going on across all parties, across all governments, Westminster and Holyrood. And that, is, in my view, is contributing to a certain disenchantment, a certain feeling that, well, it doesn't really matter if we vote. I can quote examples if you want, but you know them. I think what you need to do in looking at this is to ask yourself the questions, why are people not engaged at local level as much as they should be? The answer, in my view, is because they don't think it makes a great deal of difference. I take your point, convener. You're absolutely right, and we should pay tribute to the many, many groups out there who are active, and many of them, as you rightly say, in charge of budgets. But at the end of the day, they all come back to the point that George described. They're working within a context, and in many cases, they're working, to pick up George's point, they're working in a situation where they're the grant is more important than what they're doing with it, because the grant is going to be cut year on year, or it's going to be whatever it's going to be, and therefore that becomes critical. And if the focus comes away or goes on to the finance and comes off the outcome, as Gavin was saying, then you're not getting the kind of engagement that you're seeking to achieve. It's a very difficult thing to deal with. I don't know what the answer is myself, but I do believe that we could learn a lot of lessons by looking back over the last 20 years and seeing how the changes have come about, what I'm calling creeping centralisation. Not, by the way, I'm not just talking in terms of functions, I'm talking about money, I'm talking about lots of things. The way the rate support grant, the local government finance settlement, has been used over the last 20 years is worth a study in itself, quite frankly. Give credit to John Swinney, back in, I think it was 2011, he got rid of most of the ring fencing. Let me be equally controversial again. As a parliament, you've been around now 17 years this year, I think. When you were set up till this year, you had charge of two taxes, as I recall. You've never exercised the power to do that. I'm not arguing against that. The one place you have chosen as a parliament to exercise your powers, or the governments have chosen to do so, is in imposing a council tax freeze, which is actually the responsibility of local government. That's inconsistent, I would argue. And that needs to be addressed. Promised you'd be controversial.
Expected nothing less. Mr. Whitefield, yeah.
I would agree with all that Bill has outlined there. Going back to the earlier point about, you know, sharing best practice is one way in which this could be addressed, but also picking up on Bill's point about, you know, empowerment. Local government is arguing for greater empowerment, whether it's about the focus on outcomes rather than inputs, and the focus on teacher numbers at the moment, providing greater flexibility around about the use of resources as an example there, but also about the forward financial planning as a bean counter, as Bill had referred to earlier, just using this as an example that you know, councils argued for, you know, 3-year forward financial plans, 4-year plans that give certainty for the organisation, certainty for service users, certainty for the employees. But the same organisations have always argued we should be passing that on to voluntary organisations, community organisations, and giving them the same trust. So I think there is, you know, an ownership that has to be taken at a national government level, at a local government level, to practice what we preach. So if we're arguing for this empowerment, we should be doing the same with community organisations and supporting that as much as we can.
Mr. Black.
Well, we talked earlier about the sharing of best practice or otherwise, and talked about, I thought anyway, that there'll be a greater willingness going forward for people to look for good ideas. And there are plenty of good ideas around the country where local groups have taken control with services or assets, and the challenge really is to get that message out in a way that they can usefully pick it up. But to add to that, I think there's also a need, when you're looking at best practice, to really get down to the nub of what made a project work or what made a change work. So I took Bill's point about Clyde Gateway. I mean, Clyde Gateway has been highly successful, not because it's an urban regeneration company, but because the leadership in the Clyde Gateway are focused day in, day out in that area. That's their single focus. And the quality of that leadership is what makes it work. So I think if you can take the model as best practice, but you can add to that what really makes it work on the ground, then I think that people will be more than willing to pick up these ideas in the future.
Just John. Briefly, convener, just to follow on from George Black's comments, I think we need to, as a committee, to recognise there are a lot of communities out there doing things for themselves with small budgets because they have identified they are the only ones that can deliver
the services those communities need, because local government, central government, health boards and other agencies have failed them, and they're now doing that and delivering that themselves. And part of the community empowerment legislation was to actually give credit to those organisations that are doing it. And go back to Gavin Whitefield's point, is making sure local authorities and others support financially those community organisations that are delivering vital services today, tomorrow and in the future.
That wasn't so much a question as a statement, but we go. Finally, gentlemen, often we get criticised as a parliament for not doing enough post-legislative scrutiny, and often we don't go and revisit previous reports to see if recommendations have been implemented and whether they've made any change. Is that something you think that the successor committee needs to do? Gavin, first, please.
Yeah, I think that's important that process is in place, but I also caution against embarking on that review process too early. I often think that major initiatives are taken forward at a national, local level, and you're no sooner into the initiative than you've got scrutiny of that, and I think there needs to be adequate time given to enable the legislation to be put in place and to be effective, so to think carefully about the timing of any scrutiny, so that you've got a reasonable track record of implementation to review.
George, please.
I think that is a good idea, and I would agree with Gavin about the timing is essential. If I took health and social care integration, Audit Scotland came out with a report recently, and I think that has added to the pressure on local partnerships to deliver in the first year of operation. Now, in any major change, to deliver and demonstrate success in the first year is a pretty tall order. The scale of that change will make it even more of a challenge. So I would encourage you to go back and look at issues, and when you look at them, the type of issue you look at should be relevant to the time period. So, don't wait 6 months after, next April and be in asking local partnerships about health and social care integration, unless you're asking them about have they got structures in place, the fundamentals. But yes, I think it would actually be helpful to chief executives and leaders and politicians throughout the country if they knew that things were going to be revisited further down the line.
Bill, please.
Absolutely critical to any system, in my view. Learn the lessons. You can only do that by going in and regularly reviewing. I think the caveats that my colleagues have raised are absolutely vital. My suggestion to you would be, when you do this at the appropriate time and in the appropriate way, make sure that what you're doing is looking for best practice and making sure that you're going to share it, and avoid the sense that there's some kind of inspectorate type approach, because that can just lead to the tick box and defensive attitudes. So in addition to the timing, I think the way that you conduct such a review would be critical. And I hope, again, as I said at the beginning, I'm very impressed by you for writing your legacy paper. I wish you well, and I look forward to seeing the work of the next committee. But I hope what you will do is set out a context, and in that context, going back to review things at the appropriate time and in the appropriate way should be one of the key lessons and one of the key principles for the committee in the future.
Thank you very much for your evidence today, gentlemen. And I suspend and we move into private session. Thank you.